my respected friend, Shri Padmana Bhaiya, whom I've had the good fortune of knowing for many years, and I respect his knowledge and commitment to the nation very greatly. Professor Manohar Rao, Dr. Manohar Reddy, Srimati Sushila ji, and all very, very distinguished guests who are here, including Mr. Hanuman Chaudhary, T. Hanuman Chaudhary, Shishagiri Rao, Chandrasekhar ji, plus all the faculty and students here at Osmania University. To begin with, I must endorse what Padmana Bhaiya ji said about the directness of the subject. I really, it's a very good thing you've done. Just put it point blank. Very often we, both in academia, in diplomacy, we tend to beat about around the bush. It does not help anywhere. It is best to be direct, to the point and precise, as Padmana Bhaiya ji himself was just now. Look, I propose to deal with this subject in three parts. There are three aspects to it. Firstly, we must understand the facts of the situation with the historical background as well. Second, I think we need to analyze why China has suddenly become a little more aggressive than it was during the last 15-20 years. And finally, the options before us in terms of the response. First, as Padmana Bhaiya ji just was stating quite categorically, is that you have to really understand China's mindset. China has an illusion about itself as the greatest civilization on earth, and that it rightfully is the master of this world. The Middle Kingdom mentality. I have been a student of Chinese history, and I know that the worst period China underwent was when Britain forced open the gates of trade in China. Then there were a series of wars, the Opium War, the Boxer Uprising, the Taiping Rebellion, and many things happened. And so that period in Chinese history was one of ups and downs, and Chinese self-esteem and self-respect was gravely hurt. When the communists came to power in 1949, they had the twin plan. One was, of course, poverty and oppression, inequality, etc., etc., the usual communist themes. But most importantly, their theme was that they were the torchbearers of Chinese nationalism. That is why communism took roots in China. It could not take roots in many other countries, including India. Because in India, communists tend to run down the country, India, and its civilization. In China, the communists became the vanguard, the standard bearers. The red flag, they said, was the flag of Chinese nationalism. Mao Zedong, who for all his so-called egalitarian ideas, believed that he was in a line of the great emperors of China. Which is why you may have seen that photograph, everybody has, I think, when the new Chinese Communist Party came to power, they held their victory celebration from the ramparts of the Forbidden City. The Forbidden City represented, it was a symbol of the Chinese Empire. The Chinese emperors used to rule from there, and the Emperor of China was described as the Son of Heaven. This is the kind of mentality and the kind of history. Right or wrong, I'm not judging. You see, every country has a right to its culture, to its own beliefs, its myths or whatever, whatever. But this is the mindset. And communists in particular are not just nationalists. They are jingoists. They believe the entire neighborhood is theirs. So, they apologetic towards it. They don't believe anybody else should have any kind of power, military or economic or anything, that is comparable to theirs. I'll tell you an anecdote. Once I visited China, it was a delegation of MPs, respected Balapriji, who is known no more. He was the leader of the delegation, and some of us went there. And we had a meeting with the professors of the Chinese Academy of Security Studies in Beijing. The Indo-US nuclear pact was at that point being discussed. It had not been ratified. And you know, BJP had its opposition to it. But what struck me was that during the discussion, the Chinese professors, and fairly elderly and respected professors, they kept saying that why do you need a nuclear pact with the US? So you don't criticize your own government on foreign soil. That's not the practice. So we tried to hum and haw and kind of hedge the matter. But we said, you know, our government has taken this decision to generate more electricity. No. You are not saying the truth. You want to match China in nuclear power. By then I was losing my patience. And finally I said, yeah, so what is wrong with that? If we want to match your military prowess, and then one man brazenly, he's our host, mind you, said, no, you have no right to do it. You have no right. I said, why? So after he was kept on, you know, kind of putting his hand on mine to say, calm down, there will be an incident. So I turned to Apriji in Hindi. I said, sir, ye too much ho raha hai. Kya mazak ho raha hai? Ye toh provoke kar rahe humko. Bola, provoke mat hoi. Anyway, somehow the man thing was managed. But they kept repeating, you have no right. And we kept, finally, all of us kept saying, look, I'm sorry. We beg to disagree. Let us. I'm pointing to this. Very recently, again, one of the Chinese defense journals has written a scathing article on India acquiring a second aircraft carrier and saying that India is on a spree to build submarines, acquire aircraft carriers. Clearly, their aim is to contain China. But we are warning India that China cannot be contained. See, look at the language. Look at the way they are thinking. Navy also, we should not acquire submarines. We should not acquire anti-aircraft or aircraft carriers. We should not acquire nuclear power. So nothing we should do, we should be subservient to China. Economically, militarily, and every way. So, what is happening in Ladakh and Arunachal Pradesh, you have to see it in light of that mentality. They believe that India has to be kept in its place. And whenever India seems to be rising a bit or gaining international acceptance and respect, you need to bring it down a few notches. And with the new leadership in China, the Xi Jinping era has begun. It is going to be much more aggressive. So mind you, it is a few kilometers here, a few kilometers there. They've opened two fronts. Arunachal also just recently, as you may have seen, they are supposed to have intruded 20 kilometers, which is not the same as, you know, in Ladakh. If any of you have been to Ladakh, it is sometimes really difficult to figure out which part of the land is there and what is ours. It is a desert. It's snowy desert, some places sandy, some places rocky. There is no habitation for miles on end. There is no habitation at all. I have driven through Ladakh twice and I know that it is a really desolate, barren, windswept plateau, and there may be some genuine differences of interpreting. But then it is interesting that after keeping quiet for so many years, not only are the Chinese troops coming in, they are coming in very visibly. Riding on horses, mind you, which is a kind of throwback to the medieval times when armies used to come on horseback. Today, they don't need to. They have enough sophisticated weapons and vehicles. But I think it was generally, they also have a lot of symbolic things in their mind. That if we do this, it will have a symbolic impact. And horse riding was part of that symbolic impact. Because in the past, Ladakh was annexed by Tibetans. Ladakh was annexed by the rulers of Jammu and Kashmir and General Zorawar Singh on horseback. The British expedition, young husband, rode horses to Tibet. So I think it was a very deliberate decision to send the PLA with 50 horses, or riding 50 horses into Indian territory. And now what has happened is they come in, they spend 2-3 nights, they pitch tent, stay 2-3 nights, and before leaving, they mark on the rocks, the big boulders are there. They say, welcome to China. Welcome to China. This is China and things like that. They have obviously a few English, they have trained a few of the soldiers to write, speak or write English. Because otherwise, by and large, Chinese don't know English. Taxi driver, tourist guide, hotel, nobody knows. But some have been taught now and so they have started writing all this. Welcome to China. We are putting up banners. You may have seen photographs. Red banners saying, this is China, welcome to China. So they are doing all this deliberate provocation. And they know Indian media will pick it up. Of course, we have to pick it up. We cannot ignore it. So the idea is to put India down. I don't think it is to annex. It won't make any difference. There is nothing even strategic from what I understand. I am not a strategy expert. But from what I understand, 1-2 kilometers here and there, frankly speaking, is not of any strategic consequence. It is just that perceptions of the line of actual control vary between India and China. But that is not much. That's not the purpose of it. If that was the case, they could have done it. They would have come in another 20-30 kilometers and said, up to here is China. They have never done it. They've done. They come, intrude, go back. This is a strange Chinese way of dealing with things. That every time they have become militarily aggressive, they have never tried to hold on to the territory, mind you. There are some here who will remember 62 and what happened when they came right up to Tejpur in Assam and Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru went and bid goodbye to the people of Assam. Because they just walked through. They walked through what is now Arunachal Pradesh and used to be called Nepha then and came right up to the plains, the Brahmaputra Valley. And then they just left the whole place and went back to the position that India believed was the position that the MacMahon line. Now, in Vietnam, which they invaded in 1979. Vietnam, mind you, Vietnam was still fighting the Americans. 69, Saigon was still under US protection or other occupation. And Hanoi, with Ho Chi Minh as leader, was the kind of iconic capital of communism, militant communism. They were fighting the Americans. And China, the largest communist country in the world, invaded North Vietnam. I, unfortunately or fortunately at that time, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, who was then foreign minister in the Morarji Desai government, had gone on a goodwill visit to China. And he was there in the second day of his, when he was in China, China invaded North Vietnam. Atalji in disgust cut short his journey and came back. So mind you, I think the timing was a double motive. It was to tell Atalji, new government in India, don't mess with us, we'll do whatever we feel like. And they wanted to teach Vietnam a lesson because they had some disputes over those islands in the South China Sea. Mussoorie River in the north of China, which lies frozen most of the time. They actually managed to walk into Russia. The mighty Soviet Union. China walked in, occupied it for a few months and walked back. So you see, the point I am trying to make is that it is not China's intention to actually grab any of these territories permanently. They do this only to do their dagagiri. The analogy which Padmanabha Bhaiya ji gave about land is very appropriate. A local muscle man, he will go grab somebody's land and the actual owner will come running for land, beg, bargain, give him some money and it will be vacated. China hasn't started doing this so far, but I think suspect that very soon this dadagiri business will lead them to do this. They'll start bargaining. So, given this situation, we definitely have to think of what our strategies will have to be in the future and why China is being aggressive, so aggressive right now. All the historical reasons, Padmanabha ji has also explained Tibet, which remains a sore point with them and all that. So they will keep on doing this to India. That is what I am trying to say. India and China may become the biggest trading partner tomorrow. But still, they will do this. So that is the characteristic of China, you must remember, that money is important to them, exports are important to them. But most important is what they think is their national pride and their hegemony. They have to have hegemonic control over Asia. Be it Japan, you know Japan's ongoing dispute with China. Be it Japan, be it Vietnam, be it Laos, Cambodia, everywhere. Myanmar, their hegemony. Asia is their backyard. It is a Monroe Doctrine in reverse, like America believes that in the entire North and South American continent is America's sphere of influence and no other country has any right to do anything there. Similarly, the reverse Monroe Doctrine, China now believes that all of Asia, a kind of rim, is theirs. There is a further angle to the recent incursions in Ladakh. I believe that China and Pakistan have a symbiotic relationship in many ways. China needs Pakistan to nitpick in India. Pinprick India. The timing, the incursions in Ladakh, violations of the LOC by Pakistan. Same time. And people who studied history will remember it was done in 65 and in 71. Both times when Indian troops were busy fighting the Pakistanis, once on the Western Front and once on both the Eastern and Western Front, China suddenly made a massive show of strength along the northern border, along Arunachal, along Ladakh, to start both times to ensure that India did not move its troops and mass them totally against Pakistan. I think that something like that is going on in their mind also. But there is something further long term. You will remember what has happened in Tibet in recent years and what has happened in Xinjiang in the last few years. Tibet to China has, with the iron fist, just completely smashed them. I must again just digressing into the anecdote about our meeting with the Chinese Academy of Security Studies. The professor, the head, was asking us about the situation in Jammu and Kashmir. We told him what was going on and so on. So he said, look, you should learn from us. Typical attitude of, the superiority complex. You must learn from us. So I said, sir, tell us what your point is. When dealing with minorities, strike hard with an iron fist. So this is the opening saying in Indian delegation that that when dealing with minorities, strike hard with an iron fist. And they are unashamed. So, why do you call this? The Uyghur nation, as they like to call themselves, the Uyghur nation wants freedom from China. They are Muslim people and they believe that China has repressed Islam. They want freedom and they have already banded themselves into a group which seeks to create a Islamic Republic of East Turkestan. The East Turkestan is to the extreme west of China, bordering Kyrgyzstan and other former Soviet bloc countries, and it is an access road to also to Pakistan occupied Kashmir, where China has a strategic interest in maintaining, developing and expanding the Karakoram Pass. The Karakoram Pass gives China access to Karachi and the port they are building, Gwadar, in Balochistan. So their naval operations are also dependent on, because they can't come in through the eastern side. In winter, it's all frozen. So they have to come through the Karakoram Highway, and that's why they've also taken over, you know, Gilgit-Baltistan, which is part of POK. Pakistan has annexed it and made it part of POK. And there are Chinese have kind of come in large numbers. They have settled their workers there. They've driven out Pakistanis. You know, Pakistani government has pulled back those people who are natives of Gilgit and Baltistan, and Chinese have settled it. Atrocities are happening every day. There's a scholar, Professor Senge Sering, who comes to India also and who is mostly in the US. And he belongs to that area and he has catalogued the recent kind of atrocities that have happened in Gilgit, Baltistan, where the Chinese need complete control of that region, that part of Pakistan occupied Kashmir. And by intruding into Ladakh, China wants to ensure that India's attention is away, because eventually they want to pressure India to abandon Siachen. Because Siachen is at a height which overlooks the Karakoram Highway. They don't want India to continue that, both Pakistan and China. So you must see the larger context as to why they are doing it now. I think China's need is becoming greater because the Gwadar port is almost ready for commissioning and it will become a major naval base. India has only now woken up and is talking of developing the Chabahar base in Iran, and for its port, which will help trade with Afghanistan also. But we are late, very, very late. In Sri Lanka, Hambantota, they have already taken over. In Myanmar, they have taken over the Koko Islands. So they have really encircled India. And how they call it? They call it beautiful. They call it a string of pearls. As if there is a garland, a necklace around India. It is a necklace of cyanide. They are putting cyanide around our necklace so that any time there is any movement, the cyanide will prick and India will die. The whole movement from Ladakh onwards is part of that strategy. It varies. Sometimes you see the regime there focuses more on economy, exports, WTO, and now that they have achieved most of those aims, their exports are at a peak. India's economy is tottering, India's government is tottering, so they think this is a good time. It's a good time, you can pressure India, you can make India swallow humble pie, and any future government which comes and tries to correct this, by then they will be so entrenched that even the next government will have to think 10 times, because going to war with China is really a difficult option. Because we have allowed them to go ahead of us so much that it will be a very China. We are technologically and militarily, we are as yet, I may be not in full knowledge of all facts, but on the face of it, it appears that it will be foolhardy to try.
city permit, which is a very dangerous thing, because the employer has to report on the conduct of that city permit holder every week. Every week your employer will have to tell the police or some whichever is the authority that yes, Mr. Swanto is working well, I have no complaints, no issues and so on. And this girl, you are surprised to hear, lives in a dormitory which is hardly 10 by 10 feet where there are 40 of them living. They share a toilet, one toilet. Their parents in the place. They don't even get any spending money in this. This is the condition of restaurant workers, just as an example. This is the position, you can replicate it 1,000 times over when you talk about industrial workers or people who are making all those cheap stuff which they are flooding various markets, including the Indian market. Cheap engineering goods. You know, once I bought, so this is the conditions in which China makes its workers live. Its cities are the most polluted cities in the world. There is no environmental consciousness at all. I don't want to sound so pessimistic about them. When last night, somebody noticed that he spot a single bird anyway. Not only in Beijing, but when he went, they drove up to
Shanghai said, how will you find any birds? They've eaten up everything. And indeed, there are markets where you find this rare game, birds, and all other kind of delicacies in China. But environment has been devastated. Devastated. So no concern. Just make money, export. Export, 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 make money. Build more military arsenals. And become a superpower. Beat the US as a superpower. So, it is the economy that is actually their prime vulnerability. They are vulnerable on the economy. We have to think, our experts have, I am not an expert, but I can tell you that the life think of will have to be on how can we contain the Chinese economy or at least not assist its growth in India. Whether we should restrict the import from China, whether we should tell our businessmen not to go there and empower them more by giving Indian technology and our technology very superior.
Our neighbors, Myanmar, Malaysia, Indonesia, Vietnam, four, economically powerful, all of them. Myanmar will be the next emerging market in the world. And all these years, we did not deal with Myanmar. No matter, there was a military junta control. At least now democracy has been restored. At least by and large, no reason. We have to go on overdrive to build relations with Burma or Myanmar. Malaysia, Indonesia, Vietnam. Very important for us. China has been dealing with them for long, despite all their ideological disputes. In Vietnam, China has invaded. Now they are good pals on economic grounds. In the ASEAN, China is there and tries to prevent India from gaining any further entries. China tries to stop India everywhere. And we keep inviting them to join WTO or this, that. The history goes back to Jawaharlal Nehru and the Bandung. When he went around introducing Chou Enlai to all world leaders, all of whom knew Chou Enlai from before, and became a laughing matter there in the conference. Another thing we need to study, our academics must be told to study, our strategic people. Study how China's border disputes with Russia and Vietnam have got resolved. At whose cost? I don't know. But I've read some Chinese articles publications, expert articles saying China had border dispute with six of its neighbors. It has solved five out of those six. Only India is outstanding, and all five have been settled to China's advantage. This is the claim. Is it true? I don't know. But I think our experts need to examine this matter, because this was in a Chinese official document. I have pointed it out in Parliament, outside Parliament, to my friends in the South Bloc, that please study this. What exactly happened? How did they resolve? We need to study. We have to not only understand their mindset, but also how they are dealing with their neighbors at present. Whether we follow that or not, that's a different matter. If these have happened to China's advantage, then certainly we should not follow the same model. But we must study and know. No question of two more points. No question of withdrawing from the South China Sea, where we have gone exploring for oil. It is in international waters. China, it is not in China's territorial position. Just because it is close to China does not make it China's territory. It is not China's zamindari. We cannot permit it, we will not allow it. And the government should stand firm. I think that will be lesson enough, mind you. Vietnam, which is the country which has a coastline with South China Sea, has said India has a right. If we have the right, we will stand by it, we will explore for oil there, and China cannot, should not be able to say anything in this matter. We have to stand firm though. I have not enough faith in our government that they will stand firm, but I hope that even if there is an incident there, we do stand firm. And on the question of energy acquisition, China has been very aggressive, you know, in Sudan, in Somalia, the whole of East Africa, Kazakhstan, everywhere. Some years ago I was in Kazakhstan, and it was a very good visit. We met a lot of senior people, including the Prime Minister, senior leaders of the ruling party, and their oil minister, the petroleum minister. The petroleum minister told us that, you know, we have some very good oil fields which we are putting up for auction, and you must persuade your government to bid more aggressively for these. I said, sir, why are you saying this to us? He said, you know, everything is going to China. Every oil field China is bidding and taking. I say, if you have open tender, this can happen. But we don't want it. China is taking all of this, and we want at least, you know, a fair amount of balance. That okay, China will take some, India will take some, one or two other countries who want to bid can take some. But China is taking everything. He said, your government, which is best placed in the region, it is a regional power. If it cannot do this, then tomorrow you can't complain. I discussed with the Indian ambassador at that time, who was my friend, who was my classmate in fact. I said, well, what is the problem? Why don't we do this? He said, you see, the government of India takes 3 months to decide. The government of China takes 3 hours. That is the solution. Tender is announced, straight away China, they will get instruction, bid this, bid that, no holds barred. India, it will go to back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. We keep requesting Kazakhs to put off the tender, put off the date. It goes on like this. What to do? Well, what to do then? Then what are we complaining about? Finally, I believe we need to build alliances along the Indian Ocean. The Indian Ocean, mind you, is going to be the major playground of energy conflicts in the decades to come. India and China and some other newly emerging countries will be using this
ocean as the main access to their countries. Oil will be have to be shipped from Somalia, Sudan, the Horn of Africa and other countries and taken to India, China, Malaysia, etc. China has a big concern here, the Straits of Malacca, because everything has to pass through the Straits of Malacca. There is no other navigable channel for oil to move from Africa to China. India is at an advantage because we are controlling the region crucial to reach the Straits of Malacca. And we also want to bring in oil from these places. If we don't have strong regional alliances around the Indian Ocean Rim, it will be difficult to stop China in its acquisition of more and more oil fields and bringing in oil and starving us of oil. It's a twofold strategy. We don't have oil, you know that. All our oil has to be brought. Some coming from the Gulf and the Middle East and the rest from new fields that will come. In Africa, we have got something working with Soviet collaboration north of Japan. Very expensive stuff, but still at least some security is obtained. Myanmar, we have to work harder to achieve that breakthrough. Bangladesh is sitting on gas and not giving it to us. All these problems are there. But, you see, it's not enough to acquire your own. You also have to stop or contain your main competitor. We have to do that strategic thinking, which we are not doing. And finally, year before last, I was invited by the Sydney University to give a talk on the Indian Ocean region. That I gave, I told them roughly what I am telling you. It was a long lecture on India-Australia relations and the importance of the Indian Ocean. But what struck me, that the Chinese have overrun Australia. And I mean it. The hotel I was staying in, it was a Hilton or something, overlooking the Sydney harbour and that beautiful opera house. Almost every second person was Chinese. When I went out to the street at night, I thought I'd have some street food. The place was full of Chinese. And then, mind you, in the University of Sydney, the head of the Department of Journalism said, Dr. Mitra, you have come all the way. We have a small journalism department here. I have 40 students, postgraduate students, studying, you know, South Asian media. We really want you to come and give them a talk and answer some of their questions. I said gladly. When he was driving me into the campus, I said, Professor, what is the composition? How many Indians do you have? He said, 3. And so which is the largest group? He said, sir, Chinese. I said, how many? He said, 24. I said, 24 out of 40 is Chinese and 3 Indian. Studying South Asian media. He said, yes. Almost every department has the case. But I said, I'm really surprised that 24 students out of 40 in your department are from China and they're studying the media in India. Because where else is there any media in South Asia, frankly? So I just made 15-20 minutes. I gave them a brief informal talk. I was not really prepared or anything. And believe me, the way I was grilled by the Chinese on Anna Hazare, they were so up to date. They knew developments minute by minute. Anna Hazare, what is he? How much? What is important? They are very valid, legitimate questions. But it impressed me that they knew so much. And then I talked to the Indian students separately. I said, "Well, what is this? You are allowing them to march all over." What I could figure out, they didn't tell me clearly, that they are not really interested in journalism. They got enrolled because it was the easiest to get enrolled there at that point of time. And they are waiting to get a degree and migrate to the United States. Now, you see, what do I say? If this is the case, and if our own students, instead of understanding China, Chinese psyche, Chinese media, they are only enrolling in courses to migrate elsewhere, whereas Chinese are taking it very seriously and studying, they will naturally have an advantage. So I don't want to end on a cynical and pessimistic note. I can tell you that we have enough brain power to match and outbid China any day. Any day. Only if there is a free hand. Only if we have decisive government at every and decisive people at every level. Doesn't mean war. I'm not advocating war at all. I'm saying we have to beat them at every game. And we can do it. Mind you, China is petrified of our knowledge base, of our IT base. Chinese diplomats whom I meet in Delhi, they are scared. That's something they can't acquire. They could not learn the English in 50 years. They could not. But we are so good with our languages. Everybody has those three languages. Mother tongue, English, Hindi, standard. They can't speak anything. The Han will not even speak a small dialect version of some other language. We have major advantages. And what I was saying in the morning, only we don't realize it ourselves. Only if we were to realize our inner strength, the soul of India, our knowledge base, our brain power, nothing in this world can stop us.